The simplicity of the gospel.
Hallelujah. Good morning, church. It is always a pleasure and a privilege of mine to be always in this assembly. And I bring greetings to you this morning. And I know as Pastor Merrill is not here, but I send greetings to him because he is a man of God. And I respect him. I have a lot of respect for both him and his wife, Grace. And I thank God for them. And you know, to be honest with you, as I was praying with my sister here, as we was talking, and I in my spirit, you know, I was saying, this morning of all mornings, I really wasn't feeling well, really wasn't feeling good. And she was saying the same thing to me. But I said, his strength is made perfect in the time of our own weakness. And you know, even as I was going through, when Michael gave me the message, I think on Wednesday or Thursday, I was saying, I can't do it, Lord. I can't do it because this is my season at work where I'm so busy. And then my mom, from the last time I was here, my mom wasn't doing so well. Actually, the doctors wanted to take her foot off. But I want to thank God that it's still on today and it is healing beautifully. We have a God that is still a healer. And, you know, it was a little tedious because having to come in on evenings and deal with her, you know, and then I have to get up on mornings. So it is a little tedious. It's a little challenging. So I covet your prayers. I covet your prayers. I really do. I'm the only girl, so everything lies on me. But God will give me the strength and he will give me the grace to go through. Even as I was sitting there this morning, I don't know if Andrew can pull that song back up. I mean, as I was sitting there, I was saying, Lord, praise is what I do. Even though I'm going through, I lift my hands in praise. And that song began to minister strength even to me as I walked in this morning feeling so weak and inadequate. Praise is what I do when I want to be close to you, God. I lift my hands in praise, my God, my God. Praise is what I do, God. Oh, Jesus. I'm praising what I can. Oh, Jesus. Jesus, to praise you through the good and the bad, I praise you, whether happy or sad, I praise you in all. Lord, I thank you this morning. I thank you for every circumstance and for every situation. I thank you, God. You don't know the cost of the oil in my alabaster box this morning. So, God, I bless you. I break my alabaster box and I worship you, God. I vow to praise you, Jesus, in the midst of and in spite of, my God. It's what I do. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Lord, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart, let it be acceptable in your sight, God, for you are my strength and my redeemer. Thank you, Lord. You know, even as I I prepared one. I was looking at one thing, and then when I got here, the Lord shifted me somewhat. So I just said to the guy, just follow me. Where the Lord lead me, I will go. Just follow me. It's one of those mornings I say, God, I let go of myself and I let you. Let you be the one to speak today, God. But I want to begin by saying that the Lord is with us. In every situation and in every circumstance, if we can have the Psalms 46, if we can put Psalms 46 up, the Lord is my refuge and my strength, hallelujah. My God, this morning, he is our refuge and our strength, a very present help, a very present help in the time of trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though the waters roar thereof and be troubled, though the mountains shake with swelling thereof, there is a river, the streams whereof shall be made glad, the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacles of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God shall help her. And that right earlier, the heathen rage, the kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice, the earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. My God, that's a word for somebody today. The Lord is your refuge. The Lord of hosts, who is the King of glory. The Lord strong and mighty. The Lord mighty in battle this morning. Today, I want to reassure you that God is in you and that God is with you. And I want to say this morning that as Christians, we are not exempt from battles. We are not exempt from trials. We are not exempt from challenges. We are not exempt from adversities nor sickness. For the Bible said, the Bible made it abundantly clear that we are in a warfare and that we are fighting a real devil. But I want to reassure you this morning that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. So I want to encourage you this morning that wherever you may be at, the Lord of hosts is with us. And this morning we are not fighting from a place of defeat, but we are fighting from a place of victory and triumph. Adversity in the believer's life is temporal, but purpose is eternal. We are fighting from a place of triumph and victory because Jesus Christ has already conquered. I think when I was in the car coming in, we were singing a song about conquer. I am a conqueror. We are conquerors this morning. 2 Corinthians chapter 2 verse 14 says, now thanks be unto God who always causes us to triumph. Always. 2 Corinthians chapter 4 verse 8 says, we are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, somebody cast down this morning, but not destroyed. I wish somebody can hold on to this word this morning that we are not just conquerors, but we are more than. And I want you to be reassured that the trying of your faith worketh patience. I want to speak this morning about some people in the Bible who were also going through testing times. and trying times. And Jesus himself was in a situation where after 40 days of fasting, he was confronted by the enemy. And he was Jesus. So the word of God says that to us as Christians, that in this life, we will have tribulation and trials. But it didn't leave us there. It says to be of good cheer. Because if Jesus Christ has overcome, we will be overcomers also. And Jesus Christ confronted the enemy. And what he was able to use was the word. I want to say to you this morning that our weapons is the word of God. That's our weapon. Praise is also a weapon for the enemy. Praise and worship and prayer is also the weapons that God has given us to be able to combat the forces of evil. When I think about Joseph and the many things that Joseph would have gone through, I think that's found in Genesis. As I said, my thing, I had to make a lot of changes, so just bear with me. But in Genesis, when we read the account of Joseph and the many things that Joseph would have gone through, we know how his brothers despised him. His brothers hated him. The brothers decided that they were going to kill him. And Joseph did nothing to deserve this. All he said to his brothers, the same thing he said to his brothers, when you read Genesis chapter 50 in the latter parts, they can all see it unfolding. But at the time, they couldn't understand it. Joseph told them, y'all are going to kind of like bow to me. But they couldn't understand it. But I don't believe it was a bowingness to worship him. But I believe it was a bowing in reverence or in paying obeisance, but not to worship him. But we see the many afflictions that Joseph would have gone through from in the prison. Potiphar would have got Joseph placed in the prison for a crime that he didn't even do. And we saw how the brothers sold him in slavery. We saw how they despised him and they took the coat back to make his father feel that he was killed by a wild animal. Can you imagine your own brothers? You see the plot of the enemy? Can I tell you this morning that the enemy is no respecter of persons? It doesn't matter. But we see how Joseph got, the Bible said that God, I wonder if we can find that verse, that God was with him in every junction, in every area. While he was in Potiphar's house, God even favored him. Even though he was in prison, he was also favored. He became the one that you would call like the trustee. He was over everything. So you see, sometimes bad things happen to good people. And so we are not exempt today from the wiles of the enemy. And despite all that happened to Joseph, you know, I never heard him complaining. I never heard him murmuring. But the Bible, all throughout the chapter, the Bible keeps saying God was with him. Joseph found favor and God was with him. I want to tell you today, don't mind the challenges. Don't mind the adversity. God is with you. And when we look at the life of Joseph and the many things that he encountered, he was thrown in prison. So he went from in the pit to the prison. But we serve a God who is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we can even ask or even think or even imagine. Because when you read in chapters 50 in Genesis, when you see that there became a famine, Joseph was then the prime minister. Where his brothers, the very brothers that despised Joseph, came where Joseph was. And you know, the amazing thing is that Joseph recognized them, but they didn't even recognize him. And the beautiful thing about it is that Joseph rose to a position. So he went from in the pit, but look at him in the palace now. And I want to say to you this morning, you may be in a place where you feel as though you are in nowhere. But I want you to I want to tell you today that you are seated with Christ today in heavenly places. It doesn't matter what the enemy says about you. It doesn't matter what the enemy does to you or your family. I want you to know today that you are more than a conqueror and that you are destined to win. When you also think about the many things that was done to Joseph, you know, even as he gave his brothers the food, he said, you know, they began to cry for the type of treatment that they gave him. I don't know about you, but sometimes you can do so much for people. You bend over back for people. You go the extra mile for people. They still talk about you. They still despise you. But I want to say, do it and do it as unto the Lord, because your reward is in heaven. And despite all the things that Joseph's brothers would have done to him, you know, when he met them and he fed them, he said, and they began to cry. You know what he said? You all meant it for evil, but God turned it around for good. So I want to say to you this morning that despite of what may be happening in your circumstance or your situations, that even what the enemy meant for bad, God has a way of turning it for good. So I say to you this morning, fear not. This is found in Isaiah chapter 43, verse 1. Fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by your name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. Here God is saying that. When you go through the waters, and let me tell you, you're going to go through some waters. In this life, you're going to go through some waters. But note what the word says there, you're going through. You're not staying in the water, you know. It is a going through. It's a process. God is taking you through the waters. When you go through the waters, I will be with you. And you ain't going to only go through the waters, but there can come something that can be a little turbulence than the waters. You're going through the rivers. Hear what it says. And though you go through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. And check it. You're going from, there's a song that says, first it was fragrance, but then it turned to fire. My God. When you go through the waters, God is with you. When you go through the rivers, it will not overflow you. When you walk through the fires, you shall not be burnt. You're going to go through some fires. Sometimes it's the refiner's fire. Sometimes you got to go through the pressing. You know, if you don't press grapes, you got to press the grapes in order to get the wine, to get the juice. So there got to be a squeezing and a pressing. Sometimes God got to do it with us to get the best out of us. Sometimes he got to take us through the fire. It ain't gonna kill you. It's just purifying you. You're just going through the refiner's fire. But trust me, gold. The Bible, somebody says that when the goldsmith is doing a ring, in order for it to be fully purified, it has to go into that fire 7 times hotter. But look at the end result of that ring. It's a beautiful gold ring with a nice diamond. I say God is doing that with your life today. God is doing that with your life today. He's putting you through the fire, but it's just to refine you. It's not going to burn you. It's not going to kill you. It's just going to refine you. And in the midst of the fire and the flood, he is with you. He is with you. Psalms 23 says, yea, though I walk through, walking through again, the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, it comforts me. He is our comforter this morning. And when I think of him being a comforter, I think of him as my provider, protector, sustainer, keeper. And I remember even as I was thinking of my own life, I say, God, you have kept me through the fires. You have kept me through the floods. You have kept me through the waters. You have kept me through sickness. You have kept me through pain. I serve a God that is unstoppable. I serve a God that is unbeatable. I serve a God that is unmovable. And like Joseph, even what the enemy meant for evil, God turned it around for good. You know, and as I was thinking of my own life and the many things that I have gone through, if I live to see the next 4 weeks, I will be 60 years old. And I say, Lord, I thank you because the doctors placed a lifespan on my life at 35. But God has allowed me to live another, 25 more years? God is a good God. And I say, God, the enemy tried every way, every fashion. Oh, God, but you kept me. God's mercies kept me, so I won't let go. Tried. I'm telling you, I remember my 50th birthday, coming home from work 1 week after I turned 50, and coming home from work, I got out of the bus. Sister Shirley, you would remember this. I'm in the bus and I'm sitting down and I'm thinking of what all the things I'm going to do when I get home to prep for Sunday morning. But the enemy had a plan for me. But God had another plan. And I want to say to you, you know, when I look back at that whole situation, I mean, I am in the bus. And when I got out of the bus, I just stood up by the bus stop so the bus can pass ahead of me. But I never was able to be passed ahead. The bus exploded right there at the bus stop and licked me right over a hedge. And you know what was so amazing? The guys that pulled me out, 3 guys from the district that pulled me out, because people ran home and told my husband that I was dead and that I was under the bus. Poor man in stitches. It took him about 45 minutes to get to where he was, which would have only been 10 or 5 minutes. I believe it had him boo-bastard. But I remembered while I was sitting waiting for the ambulance to come. And I say this because I wanted to tell you that the enemy is no respecter of persons, and he doesn't care. The Bible says he come to do 3 things. He's come to kill, steal, and to destroy. The word of God says that he come to sift us as wheat. And we have got not to be ignorant about the devil's devices. And I remembered, I said, when the 3 guys who pulled me out, when they said, I don't know how you survived this. But it had to be. You know, there's rasters, so they didn't want to say God. They say it got to be the man upstairs that held you. Because look at where we pulled you from. I was between 3 stakes. 1 stake here, 1 here, and 1 there. 3 stakes that were up in the ground. 3 stakes that were up in the ground. I came in between them. That had to be God. That had to be God that kept me. God's mercies kept me, so I wouldn't let go. And when they brought the pictures to show me where I was and the 3 stakes that were up, all I could do is cry to my God and thank him for keeping me. But I want to say that to say this. I remember that when my husband was in Dominica, and it was about 2 weeks before he actually came home. And I remember as we were recounting all that had happened with that accident, I remember Michael said to me, and I told the enemy, we got to be real careful. And we got to be careful how some people pray for us here. Everybody that praying for you and praying good prayers, you got to use wisdom. I remember my husband was in Dominica, and he said to me, something strange kind of happened. And he said, I remember the night this particular person wanted to take them out. And he said somehow the spirit of the Lord said not to go. Don't go. And he called and he canceled. And he said that same night, he had a real bad dream. And he said, now that he's looking back at what happened after 2 weeks that he came home and this incident happened with the bus and me, he said, the Lord said, no, I remember in that dream what I saw. It was me and you in that dream, and there were like daggers. Daggers were being thrown in the dream, but we were ducking and bowing. They were throwing at you, and they were throwing at me, and we were being ducking. And he said, when I look back at the whole thing, I know why now God stopped me from going out that night that I was scheduled to go, because maybe if I was disobedient and I have gone, maybe you would not have been saved. Be careful of the people that sometimes say they're praying for us. It is not always good prayers. And I say that to say this, you got to use wisdom. I remembered even about 3 weeks ago, my husband has a morning prayer program. And I remember listening to a pastor who was also speaking. And he said his wife was always in very good health. His mother-in-law was constantly bringing things for the wife. Bringing things for the wife. Bringing things for the wife. And he said his wife was curious about it. And the last thing that came, she refused not to eat it. And she had a stroke the next day. And he said when he found out the whole thing, his mother was working witchcraft on his wife. He found out all that was happening. So I'm saying to you, we have got to be aware of the enemy's devices and ask the Lord to give us the spirit of discernment to be able to discern. We need it. We need it. We need it. But I want to say to you today, God is with us in the fire, in the floods, and in the water. I want to say to you this morning that the trying of your faith worketh patience. We know the story of the three Hebrew boys. What I like about the three Hebrew boys and what I like about Joseph is that these men's faith were impeccable. They minimized their fears, but they maximized their faith. And when you think about the three Hebrew boys, when Nebuchadnezzar made the golden image and asked them to bow down to it, when you hear the song of the harp and the song of the trumpets and the drums and all these things, they wanted the three Hebrew boys who were Daniel's friends to bow down and worship a false god. But today we make a declaration, I will serve no foreign gods, nor any other treasure. For Jesus, you are my only God. I believe that they sang that in their hearts. Your spirit without measure, unto your name I will bring. The only God I am bowing to is the true and living God. They made a decree. They said, we will bow to no foreign gods. They minimize their fears, but they maximize their faith in God. And you know what I like about them maximizing their faith? They weren't timid. They said, this is what they said, even if the God that we serve don't deliver us, even if he doesn't deliver us, we are not bowing. That's a strong faith. And today, we got to do it. There, people want you to compromise with your Christian life and do certain things. You're going to make a stand. If you don't stand for something, you're going to fall for everything. You got to make a stand. There must be a demarcation between the Christian and the unsaved. If the unsaved can do it, so be it. That's your lifestyle. But when I change worlds, I am different. I'm different now. The places I used to go them no more. The things I used to do them no more. The things I used to say them no more. You have got to make a strong stance in your Christian life. You cannot be in and out. It is either that, the Bible says, you can't be lukewarm. You're either hot or you're cold. You either love Jesus or you're for the devil. And these men stood tall. Because their purpose in the heart, like Daniel. Daniel's purpose in his heart, I will not defy my body with the king's meat. And Daniel was so fierce, again, maximizing his faith and minimizing his fears. Daniel opened up the windows. When I want to see me praying, this is who I pray to, no other God. Daniel opened up the windows to show them that I am praying to God, the true and living God. And the decree came out. And check them. They placed Daniel in the lion's den. They placed the three Hebrew boys in the fiery furnace. But look, watch our God. Watch our God. You see, the Bible says that when you suffer as a Christian, God gonna bring you out and show you out tall. The Bible said that don't suffer as a busybody or a person causing conflict. Don't suffer like that. But if you're suffering, because the Bible says when you suffer for righteousness' sake, God is going to elevate you. Listen, my God, at my workplace, I remember years ago, she's not there anymore. There was a particular supervisor used to give me nurture. I never did her anything wrong, bad, never talk her name, never size with nobody. But you see, when the favor of God is on you, sometimes people just hate you for it. You don't gonna do people anything. Sometimes people just hate you for the favor of God that is on your life. I never do her anything. And I came there as a simple cashier and a sales clerk. And I don't know why. If this whole shelf got clean and three people got clean it, she used to make my one do it. When it should be done with three persons, she would make my one do it. If stock got to come down and there's two or three people got to bring down stock, she only sending me. She's sending the others. But watch my God. One morning my boss came in. And that's why I tell you, you know, when God is for you. Church, when God is for you. I didn't even know my boss was watching me from a camera in his office, because I never knew that. And my boss, in 2 weeks' time, my boss said to me, I know you came here as a cashier and a sales clerk, but I have some things in the office that I want to assign to you. The Lord show me you. And I want you to assign you to do these things in the office. And it was, I'm telling you, and the Lord took me from under her. And look, in a matter of 4 to 5 weeks, she got fired. When God is for you. When God is for you, no man can be against you. And God was for Daniel, and God was for Joseph, and God was with the three Hebrew boys. Even the Bible said that when they were thrown in the fire, the Bible said that there was a look like the Son of Man. There was a fourth man. Jesus was with them in the fire. There was a fourth man in the fire. I want to say to you today that you may be in the Daniel's den, but the God that we serve can shut the mouths of the lions. You may be in a fiery furnace, but today there is a fourth man in it with you. That's the God that we serve. That's the God that we serve. He is able. More than able. I want to encourage you this morning. Don't give up. Don't give in. God is with you. You may be in the fiery furnace, but he is refining you this morning. God is in you, and God is with you. Paul and Silas in the book of Acts. My God, when the Holy Ghost came upon them men, the Bible said that those men were doing damage, but they were doing good damage. They were winning souls. The Bible said that the church, souls were being added to the church daily. Souls were being saved. Persons were being deliverance. But look at the enemy again. The enemy wanted to stop them and stop them from doing what God called them to do. And so they were placed in prison for preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. And many times when we are telling people about Jesus Christ, they don't want to hear, but you tell them, because it's a commission that God has given to all of us. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel. It's not just for the pastor. It's not just for a few people. It's a commission to all of us. But because they were given their faith, the enemy wasn't pleased. the governors and the princes and all these people came down and they locked Paul and Silas. But I love it. Look what they did. The Bible said that they sang praises. They sang praises even though they were in prison. And as I was reading that account in Acts, I said, you know what? They were in prison, but prison wasn't in them. That's the difference. Because even though they were in prison, they didn't complain. They didn't fret. They didn't anger. They didn't mourn. They weren't mournful. The Bible said that they sang praises like what we did this morning. Praise is what I do when I'm going through. That's what they did. I believe in the prison, they probably were saying, when trouble's in your life, sing praises. When trouble's in your life, sing praises. When trouble's in your life, sing praises. Hallelujah. Praise is what I do. Even though they were in prison, the Bible said they sang praises unto our God. And watch my God again. The Bible said suddenly, you're going to get some suddenlies. I told God at 60, when I turned 60, I said, God, my expectations is that some suddenlies got to come. The Bible said suddenly at midnight, the earthquake came and shook the prisons. And look at Paul and Silas. Paul and Silas didn't take the opportunity to run through the doors. Read it. Go back and read it in Acts. They stood. And the jailer that would have beaten them, placed their feet in shackles, was about to run and kill himself. And Paul said to him, don't. We are all here. This is miraculous. You can imagine a prison door open and you're in a prison and you're trying to get out. And you're trying to get out. The prison doors has opened. But Paul is saying we are all here. Because this was a miraculous miracle, you know. This was a supernatural thing happening, not the natural. This was a supernatural invention because of the praises. You see, that's why you've got to praise. Because when you praise, it brings walls down. When the people were going around the walls, they said, set the singers out front. Jehoshaphat said, set them out front. Because praise is a weapon. Praise is a worshipful thing. And it breaks barriers. Sometimes I can't even pray. But I can just worship. And when I done worship, I get my breakthroughs because it's a weapon. And the Bible said that the jailer bowed before Paul and Silas and asked the question, what must I do to be saved? The miraculous of God. What must I do to be saved? And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved. And it didn't just stop there, you know. He said his household. The household, his entire household. Even what the enemy meant for evil. Watch my God, turn it around for good. The Bible said the Philippian jailer and his family were saved. They were baptized and they were saved. Praise is what I do. Even though I'm going through, I've learned to praise him. I want to say to you this morning, you may be in a prison. Because sometimes people are at home and they feel like they're in a prison. Can't talk hard. If you're going to unsafe people and you're singing a gospel song, I'm tired hear you singing that. You in your own home and you feel like a prisoner. The children got up the dub music to all ragga, 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 ragga. But when you play an Amazing Grace, they don't want to hear that. And you in your own home and you feel like a prisoner. You can't play your gospel music, but he ragga, ragga, hi. Sometimes you're in a marriage and you're in bondage. Husband didn't want you to go out. Can't have no friends. Bondage. So sometimes we are externally free. But sometimes there are things that got us bound internally. And I ask you today, like Paul and Silas, they were externally and internally free. That's why they were able to sing and praise, because they knew in whom they believe. But I say to you today, whatever have you bound, or whatever might be bounding you, today I say that who the Son has made free is free indeed. Jesus Christ came that you and I will have freedom. And we are free today. We are going to be celebrating Independence Day, I think, on Saturday. But are we really free as a country? Are we really free? We gotta keep praying for our nation, because a lot of stuff is happening in this nation. For the last 60 years, I have seen some things in this nation that I didn't see before. We have got to start praying and warfaring for this nation. This is where we live. Everybody focusing on America politics, but let's check what is happening here, right here. We gotta pray. We gotta pray for our prime minister. We gotta pray. The Bible says, pray that we may live peaceably. That's what the word of God says. Whether you're a BLP or DLP, it's not about politics. It's about praying for where I live. I live in Barbados, not St. Lucia or Dominica. I'll pray for them too. But I pray for, this is my Samaria and my Jerusalem. And then I pray for the uttermost parts. This is where we live. So I say to you today that God is able, and he is well able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we can even act or even think. And I just want to encourage you, keep holding on to God's unchanging hand. Because even what the enemy means for evil, I wonder if Andrew has that song. God, or if the worship team here knows that song. Even what the enemy meant for evil, God turn it for my good. That's a song. Anybody here is familiar with that? Worship team knows that? Even what the enemy meant for evil, God turn it for my good. God turn it for my good. For your glory, your plans are still to prosper. You have not forgotten us. You're with us in the fire and the flood. You're faithful forever, perfect in love. You are sovereign over us. Even what the enemy meant for evil, God turn it for my good. God turn it for my good, for your glory. Even in the valleys, you are faithful. You're working for my good. You're working for my good, for your glory. I want to just thank you for listening. And I just want you to remember that when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overthrow you. And when you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned.
The simplicity of the gospel.
If you do not have a local assembly, feel free to join us for an exhilarating time of worship. Our services are Sunday morning at 10 a.m. Sunday evening, healing and deliverance at 6:30 p.m. Join us in prayer on Tuesdays at 7 p.m. and for Bible study on Thursdays at 7 p.m. Let's fellowship and enjoy
the simplicity of the gospel.